think today, if you want to do get the state of the art, or if you want to get good results, you need to get deep learning. Now, the talk today will not be about how to get, about some kind of new algorithm for getting better results with deep learning, but the talk will be about trying to understand better this new mechanism and try to get some feeling of why this architecture is so successful. So when we talk about deep learning, there are some nuances, but in the very simple form, it is a concatenation of a simple layer, where each layer is a linear operation followed by a non-linear function. And then when you concatenate this simple structure, you get a deep neural network, and the magic is how to choose the weights in the linear part and what simple function you should choose in this nonlinear part. Once you know how to set the weights and set this nonlinear function, you can solve any problem in the world. And people today solve with it any problem in the world. So it's so in the linear part, many times we use images instead of a simple linear part, people use convolutions, and the reason for that is that we know that images are shift invariant, so the convolution with the pooling layer gives us some kind of invariance. And in the nonlinear part, usually two types of nonlinearities are used. In the past, people used sigmoids and hyperbolic tangent, and the reason for that is that they wanted to get some kind of binary behavior, which have similar behavior to the brain. Today, people use more the ReLU activation function, which is basically the maximum between a value and zero. And these operations are applied element-wise on the input. So if you have an input vector and you apply this function, you just apply this nonlinearities in an element-wise fashion. And another nonlinearity that is very popular is the pooling or aggregation operation, where you take an input vector and then take the maximum value of these operations, the mean, the average, or some LP norm. So basically, this is the general structure of deep neural networks, and any deep neural network that you will look at will have this structure, will have nonlinearities followed by nonlinearities, and the nonlinearities will be either one of these ones or pooling.
The mean is not not.
Yeah, it's not nonlinearity, right? But
it's linear.
It's right.
It's the linear nonlinearity.
Particular
case.
Linear, yeah. It's particular case of nonlinearity.
So, in this talk, we'll try to understand why deep neural networks work. There are many questions that we can ask. We can ask what is so special about the structure, what is their capability, what we can do with them, how many training samples we need to train the network, what is the role of the activation functions, what happens to the data throughout the layers, what is the role of the depth of the deep neural networks, or what is the role of pooling. So of course, we will not answer all these questions. I hope that we'll at least be able to answer partly one of them. But, and of course, we are not the only ones that try to look at these questions. And these questions, some people think that deep learning started only at 2012, and they forget that all the area of neural networks started from the 80s and from the 90s.
Much earlier, Kolmogorov.
Okay, also from the 60s. But the train neural networks are, people understood how to train them more around the 80s. So people used at the 60s neural networks, but they were not in the same form that we have them today. In the 80s and 90s, the neural networks that were used at these years are more similar to the ones that we use today. And at the end of the 80s, beginning of the 90s, there was a very nice result, the universal approximation theorem, which was proven by Hornick and Saibenko. So Hornick proved it, and then Saibenko generalized it in 91. And they showed that it is possible to approximate with neural network, any Borel, any measurable Borel function, and people were very happy with that and thought that, okay, now we can solve any problem in the world. The problem is that someone tell you that you can use, that neural network can do something, but they don't tell you what should be the weights in the neural network in order to do this thing, how many layers you need, what are the number of parameters, and maybe you can, so maybe you can approximate with the neural network any function in the world, but maybe you will need an infinite number of parameters. So it is a very nice result, but it's not practical. Then several works from the recent years studied the depth of the network, and they showed that if you look at a deep network and compare it to a shallow network, with probability one, if you approximate a function that you can approximate with a deep network, can be approximated only with a shallow network that has an exponential number of parameters compared to the deep one. So these are very nice results that was proven by a series of works. Now there is just one note that you should keep in mind in this, when we set such results, when we say that with probability one, that any function that we can approximate with a deep network, with probability one we will need a shallow network with an exponential number of parameters, we need to remember that the measure of the natural numbers in the real numbers is zero, but we are still very interested in the natural numbers. So the fact that the measure of the shallow networks that can approximate the same function that are approximated by deep network is zero, say that shallow networks are weaker, but it is not necessarily that they are not useful, because the natural numbers are useful. So when someone gives you results with measure zero, you should always keep in mind the natural numbers, and that this is how you learn to count on your reaction. Another nice result, try to study the generalization error of the networks, and they try to see how the errors scale with the number of training samples that we have. A result by Shalev Schwartz and Ben David showed that the number of training samples scale as the number of parameters in the network, and they use the VC dimension arguments to prove that. And Neishabur et al. Showed that the number of training samples scale at the norm of the weights in the deep neural networks, but it is has an exponential dependency on the depth. In this talk, we will also try to understand how the number of training samples depends on the architecture of the network. And I will say just one note about these two results, is that there is a very recent paper by Ben Reft and his colleagues, so I should have put it in, but they didn't do that, that showed that any argument that is based on the Rademacher complexity or the VC dimension, like the arguments that are used in these works, doesn't really explain why deep neural networks generalize. They made a very nice experiment where they showed that they use the same architecture, and then they take random data, and then they take data with structure, and then when the data have structure, the network generalizes well. When the data doesn't have structure and it's just random data, the network is able to adapt to the data, and it doesn't matter how complicated is the data. And their conclusion is that if you use Rademacher complexity that is agnostic to the structure of the data, or if you use VC dimension type arguments that are only dependent on the network itself, then the arguments about the generalization are not relevant always, and because of that, in our work, we take an approach that takes into account the structure of the data, and because of that, our argument is still valid. Yeah.
Is there an accepted way of training? I mean, you speak about size of data for training, but is there an accepted way of training?
Okay, so this is a good question. So here, when we talk about this type of training, so we don't do everything. So we look at the number of training examples and the best network that you can adapt. So, okay, so I will correct myself. This type of results and the results that I will get in a minute, look at the generalization error and they tell you, okay, so you have a network, this network have certain properties, and you achieved a certain error on the training set that you have. What would be the error on the test set? So they study the difference between the error on the test set and the error on the training set. So you give me an architecture, I calculate certain parameters using their results or using our results, and then it will be able to tell you, okay, so because your network has these properties, it will generalize better than another network that had another properties. So you train how in any way you want, you get a certain error on the training, and I will tell you what would be the difference to the test error. Now there are results that talk also just about the training. I will get to them. Another result looked at the pooling stage, and it showed that the pooling stage provides shift invariance, which is desirable for images. Brun et al. Also showed in a very nice work a relation between pooling and phase retrieval, and then used phase retrieval algorithms to recover the input from the output of the network. In a very nice series of works, it has been shown that if you use deeper networks, you have more local minima, but all the more local minima concentrate around each other. So in the past, people thought that the main problem in deep networks is that you get stuck in a local minima, but then they found a very nice or very strange phenomena that if you train the same network with different initializations, you end up with different weights, but all these networks with all these different weights get almost the same result at the output, almost the same loss.
Is a result for large networks.
Yeah, this is a result for large networks. And people didn't understand why it happens, and then a series of works drove the connection between neural networks and something which is called the spin glass theory in physics, that study the minima in some monomials, and they showed that because of this relation, all the minima in the network are concentrated and close to each other. So also, if you don't get to the global minima, you are okay because all the local minima look the same. And because of that, you prefer a deeper network over shallow network, where in shallow network, the local minima are widely spread. So if you are stuck with the local minima, it's really a problem.
This is part of the result about shallow network?
They draw a connection to this spin glass theory. Okay. And then they show that for shallow network, the minima are spread, and for deeper network, the minima are closer to each other. Now, the connection that they do is, of course, they have some relaxation, and they use some randomness, but the result still is very interesting, and it explains why, in some sense, why we are happy with deeper networks. A very interesting recent result by Yaniv Romano and Vardan, and Mickey showed the relation to dictionary learning. They showed that deep neural network can be viewed as a pursuit problem that recover the representation under a certain convolutional dictionary in sparse representation. And we have another work that showed that if you look at deep neural network with the random Gaussian weights, then this network is good for classifying the average points in the data. But when you do the training, you actually are treating the boundary points. So till now, it's just a background of previous works. And now I will get to the two results that I will discuss today. Today we will try to consider two things that we can, two properties of neural network. The first one, we look at the generalization error of neural network, and we see that it depends on the deep neural network input margin. And the second thing that we will see, if time will permit, we will see that deep neural network may solve optimization problems. So the first thing that we consider is the generalization error. And we will I will just look at the network structure that we are considering. We will assume for simplicity that we have just two classes. And at the output of the network, we have a softmax or a linear classifier, our result holds. And we will assume that we have a certain data that can be separated by a certain line. And we have two classes, and our goal is to try to understand what is the error that you get if you are able to separate this data. Now, something that I want you to note from this diagram is that if we have a neural network with a linear classifier at the output, with a softmax we'll have the same thing, but with linear classifier the same. So let's assume that we have a linear classifier at the output, so we have a linear separation line. Now, this separation line that we have at the output transform to a non-linear separation line at the input. And there are two terms that we will use afterwards, and I will define them again, but just want you to keep them in mind. We have a term, we have, with respect to this separation line, we have the input margin, and we have the output margin of the classifier and the input margin. The output margin is the difference between the separation line or the separation boundary and the points in the data, like you have in SVM. And the input margin is the distance between the separation line as it looks at the input and this point. And now we'll try to understand the generalization error that we get in the neural network. So in training, when you train a neural network, you reduce a certain loss, training. You minimize it, but you minimize it only with respect to the training. And this classification error reduces as the number of training examples L increases. However, we are interested not in reducing the training error. We were of course interested in reducing the training error, but our final goal is to reduce the test error or to reduce the classification error that we will get on points that are not in the training data. Because for the training data, we know the answer. And the question is, what is the relation between the test error and the training error?
Assume no regularization.
Okay, we will add regularization to make the test and training error very similar. But now we assume that I'm just now defining what is the generalization error. So the generalization error is the difference between the training error and the testing error. Now,
tell me the when you have this geometric picture, which I like very much in the previous one. Can you say that, for example, the complexity of this curve, this separation curve, is set by the number of layers that you have? I mean, you know, like could we say that in this two-dimensional example, if you have one layer, you have only one separation line, and if you have two layers, you can get a wedge like this, that if you have three, then you can get 3 points or something. Is there a...
There are some relations between that. There are very interesting relationships between the layers, especially if you have the relative nonlinearity.
I thought that's what you get, because you get a lot of linear. No, but there are more. Yeah, it's not.
There are more. Even with wide inner layer, you can get complicated because you have metrics, not only a vector of weights.
Yeah. But these relationships are used in the work of Neishabur with Natis Rebro. They use this relationship They use this relationship for the redo, and use so.
Okay, so it's not a simple.
It's not a simple, but thing. You can draw some nice recursive separation for certain nonlinearities. Okay. So for redo, you have very nice recursive relation. For other nonlinearities, it is more complicated. But our results hold for any nonlinearity that is differentiable, or partially that is differentiable almost in any place. Okay. Now, something that we should understand about the generalization error, the relation between the training and the testing, is that given that the generalization error is something that is very important, because if we want just to minimize the training data, so we can just take one nearest neighbor. If we use one nearest neighbor, we get zero error on the training data, but we get very large generalization error. But on the other hand, having generalization error which is zero is also not our main goal. We would be very happy to have generalization error which is very low combined with the training error that is very low. Because if we take just a classifier that is random or that is giving zero to everyone, it will have zero generalization error because it acts in the same way on the testing and the training, but I don't think that you want a random classifier. So you need to remember, we will focus now only on the generalization error, but you should remember always that we are interested both in minimizing the generalization error and the training error, which end up together to the testing error. Okay. So, in order to reduce the generalization error, there are many regularization techniques. I think the earliest one, probably someone will correct me, is the weight decay that penalize the deep neural network weights. Another very popular one is the dropout that randomly drop units along with their connections from the neural network. There is another extension of dropout which is the drop connect. Another nice regularization is the batch normalization, which try to make some whitening to the data to make the training simpler. A very interesting result by Ben Recht and Zinger and Hart showed that stochastic gradient descent, the technique for training, reduce the generalization error. So people are usually using stochastic gradient descent to accelerate the convergence and for because it's easier to make gradient descent in this way. But this work showed that stochastic gradient descent is not only good for optimization, but it's also good for reducing the generalization error. Another interesting work is the path SGD that found out that if you have a network that you just play with the weights, that it will give you the same output if you use the relu nonlinearity, because it's scale invariant in some places. Different scales give you different results in the training, in the back propagation. Because of that, they decided that they found out that in order to improve the convergence, it's better to have the same scaling all the weights, and they have this path SGD algorithm that normalizes the path in the training to get better convergence, and there are many other regularization techniques. Now, so as we are talking about the generalization error, I will re-mention again the two results that I mentioned at the beginning. That bound the generalization error of the network. The first one is the rely on the visit dimension, and the Shalesh and Tafaris and Ben David showed that the generalization error is smaller than the order of the number of parameters in the network times the log the number of training samples divided by the number of training samples. And the result of Neishabur showed that the generalization error is smaller than 1 over the square root of the number of training samples times 2 to the power of the number of layers that we have, okay, times the product of the Frobenius norm of the weights in the network. Now, the problem with these two results is that this result In this result, the generalization error grows with the number of parameters, and this result grows exponentially with the depth. And as I said before, there is a new paper by Ben Recht that showed that other reasons why we are not with these results. Why VC dimension and rather macro complexity type arguments are not the way to go for the generalization error. And we believe that our result solved this problem. So,
so, can you go for a second for the last
one? Yeah.
Does it basically mean that if you want, if we double the number of examples in the training, not the bound, but the actual generalization error will be reduced by the factor of square root of this thing?
Yeah. Most generalization error that you will get, or when you will see a result about generalization error, usually it will be of such a form. You will have 1 over square root L, the number of training examples, times something that is dependent on your classifier. Okay? So if you don't have this 1 over square root L, so you cannot do better, much better than this. And if you don't have this factor, so probably the one that made the proof didn't do something correct. And the important and the interesting thing is what you have in this part. So you have the 1 over square root of L, so tell you that the number of training examples reduce the generalization error factor of 1 over square root of L. And then you have another term that tell you how the properties of your classifier increase or decrease the generalization error, and how you should tweak your classifier to reduce the generalization error. So in our work, we propose another a bound for the generalization error, and we'll try to use this bound to understand better the behavior of the network on the one hand, and on the other hand try to use it to propose new ways to regularize the network. So our bound is the following. It shows that the generalization error is more or equal than the square root of the covering number of the input data with the balls of size gamma divided by 2, where gamma is the input margin, divided by square root the number of training examples. So basically what we have, so as I said, our bound depends on the input margin, and the larger the input margin we have, the bigger the balls we are allowed to cover the data, and the bigger the balls that we allow to cover the data, the smaller the covering number will be, and because of that, the generalization error will be small. So someone may suggest, okay, it is great, and our theory relies on the robustness framework by Xuanzong. So someone may suggest, okay, great, we have such a bound. So what we'll do, we'll use a regularization strategy that tries to minimize the input margin. The problem that minimizing the input margin is a hard problem. And what usually people are doing is minimizing the output margin. Maximizing, of course. So maximizing the input margin is a hard problem. So what people are doing usually is maximizing the output margin. And all of you know that from SVN. In SVN, basically what you're doing is using the Higgs laws to maximize the output margin. So what we'll do, we will bound the input margin as a function of the output margin and another parameters of the network that will help us to regularize the network better. So we get this series of lower bounds on the input margin. So we'll look at these lower bounds. So in all of them we have the output margin, which is easier to maximize by the SVN problem. And it's maximized by many cost functions like the Hinjos. But let's consider the denominator, which is more interesting. So if we look at the weakest bound, weakest lower bound, the loosest one, so you'll see that we get here that the input margin is greater or equal than the output margin divided by the product of the Frobenius norm of the weights in the network. And this is exactly the same factor that appeared in the work of in the bound of Neishabur and Srebro. And of course, if we want to maximize this margin, so we want to minimize this denominator. So with the weakest bound that we get the result that is very similar, or very similar understanding to the one by Neishabur. And we can minimize this factor by using weighting.
I have a problem. If you choose one of the weights to be really, really, really small, then you maximize the gap in the input as much as you want.
Okay, so you need to remember
that you normalize H.
Okay, not only normalize, you need to remember that we say that we want both to minimize the generalization error and the training error. Mm-hmm. So, of course, so if I will select everything zero, I will get a network with the zero generalization error, but this is not a useful network.
Mm-hmm. Would it be fair to say that regression normalization basically balances the way so that to get the multiplication of the smallest?
So batch normalization is related to our result. It's more related to our second inequality that relates the input margin to the spectral norm. And indeed, yes, you can think about batch normalization as a way to balance these weights. Okay. Now, if we look at the first inequality that we have, it relates the input margin to the output margin divided by the Jacobian that we have in the network, and then divided by something that is related to the Jacobian that we have on the data points. Now, something that you should take into account is that if we use the ReLU nonlinearity, the ReLU nonlinearity divides our plan to be piecewise linear. And because of that, the Jacobian in this case is also piecewise linear, and therefore it is easy to calculate. It became piecewise constant because the plane is piecewise linear, so the Jacobian becomes piecewise constant. It's easy to calculate it. And therefore, if you use the Jacobian bound, we get better results. And we checked it empirically, and we compared regularization that is based on the Jacobian and a regularization that is based on the weight decay. And we found that if we look at a regularization, so we have a column with no regularization, column with weight decay, and column with our new regularization. And we found out that if we use regularization that is based on the Jacobian, we get results that are much better